Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us. We have two wonderful poets with us today. Susan Hayden will read first, and then Celeste Goyer. Susan Hayden is a poet, playwright, novelist, and essayist. She writes about identity and belonging, the search for home, and life and love after loss. Her writing has appeared in the anthologies Los Angeles in the 1970s, Weird Scenes Inside the Gold Mine, Rare Bird Lit, The Black Body, Seven Stories Press, I Might Be the Person You Are Talking To, Padua Playwrights Press, and elsewhere. She's the creator, curator, producer of the monthly literary series Library Girl, now in its 13th year at Ruskin Group Theater in Santa Monica. In 2015, Hayden received the Gruia Finkel Artist and the Community Volunteerism Award for her, quote, significant contributions to the energetic discourse within Santa Monica's arts community, end of quote. Library Girl was named Best Local Literary Series and the Argonauts Best of the West Side Editor's Picks. Honesty, love, strength of line are evident in Susan Hayden's writing. Her acclaimed Library Girl reading series shows how one person can make a major contribution to the LA literary community. A brilliant writer, Susan Hayden.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Harry, I just want to say I wouldn't be here if it were not for you. You were my first poetry friend, and you got me my first featured reading, and you also got me to Holly, your late, amazing, singular wife. And so all of this it's like this thread of connection really is, it's all because of you that I'm here and that I'm helping other writers as you did, as you do. And you've been such an inspiration to all of us.
Thank you, Susan. It all goes back to the Bodhi tree.
It does. But that's a story for another day. But oh yes, it does. I can say in one sentence that I lived on that street in West Hollywood where the used branch of the Bodhi tree was. And I was in there one night in the poetry section and a book fell into my lap and it was The Streets Inside, 10 Los Angeles Poets. I'd been writing poetry secretly. I found Harry, kind of fell in love with him. You never knew that, or maybe you did, and tracked you down at a reading at Beyond Baroque. And that was the beginning for me.
You've done fabulous and you've done a great service to the, you know, to the literary community with not only your own writing, but your Library Girl reading series. I just love your series. So thank you very much, Susan, for everything.
Thank you. So I have three pieces and I don't know if I have the time to read all of them or not, but basically I brought these because I write in so many different forms, and I write plays, I write poems, essays, stories, memoir pieces, I write tributes. And so I'm going to start with a memoir piece that I wrote within the last year called The Beautiful Ugly. And here it is. Love yourself, move your body, and watch your portions, he instructed. Richard Simmons was only a local celebrity in 1978, just months before he would explode onto the scene and become internationally known and stay in the limelight for 40 years until he couldn't hang on to himself anymore. We were 10 leotarded 11th graders, dancing to the beat of Macho Man during a private class held in his exercise studio. It was the sweet 16 of my oldest friend, Ruthie. Her calligraphied invitation read, come join me in Beverly Hills for a workout at Anatomy Asylum and for salads at Ruffage. This was a complete departure from the usual lavish luncheons for such an occasion, wealth displays that define the bourgeoisie of Encino. Ruthie and I grew up around the corner from each other since 6 months old. We were thrown together by our mothers out of convenience. We weren't anything alike, which made us more like sisters. Our allegiance was cemented at age 5 when we nearly drowned together in my family pool. No one was watching as we traveled from the shallow end to the deep end and sunk. Her father, a non-swimmer, looked up and realized he couldn't see us. He jumped in and literally saved our lives. She was, and still is, my most well-adjusted friend. In high school, she got an A in health, was a member of World for Women Fitness Center, and ate half a grapefruit a day. She knew early on how to take care of herself from the inside out. She is my compass and my anchor. Back then, the ideal beauty was slender and tan, with big boobs and long flowing hair, preferably blonde. I was a synagogue girl, pale and chubby. I hated exercising. I did own a wardrobe of danskins that I wore as regular clothing. Danskins are not just for dancing. I favored their wraparound skirt, had one in every color. In 1970, the average age a girl started dieting was 14. I was the queen of the crash. Scarsdale, Atkins, Stillman, the cookie diet, the cabbage soup diet, the sexy pineapple diet, the Beverly Hills diet, the Israeli army diet, AIDS appetite suppressant candy, and Dexatrim. I used my body sparingly in gym class at Birmingham High when I wasn't busy faking an injury. And the night I found myself naked and underneath a 20-year-old man, losing my virginity in the name of true love, only to find out it was a one-off. By 15, I'd been touched without my consent at least 3 times. First by a babysitter when I was 8, at 12 at a sleepover by someone 38 whom I'd trusted, who reached for me in the dark with his hand, and at 14 when a friend's older brother violently pounced on me, covering my mouth, holding me down, calling me a slut, groping and threatening me. I successfully fought him off, but he left deep, bloody scratches I'd cover up with Joe Blasco's TVC15 neutralizer. Somehow, I managed to hang on to myself. These secrets were stuffed away in emotional drawers. There were no confessional talk shows on TV, and recovered memories weren't in style yet. My mom listened to Dr. Tony Grant on KABC, and though I was tempted to phone in my laundry list and ask her for help, she seemed anti-feminist to me. It was different then than it is now. Kids weren't given skills to use in the event of a transgression. People got away with all kinds of things without ever getting caught. And my body felt like a vandalized temple. I learned to wear weight as a shield, was a master of camouflage. I was mortified at being seen in tights and a leotard at an exercise class in front of my friends. "Thanksgiving is this Thursday," Richard Simmons warned us. "You know what that means. Everybody gains 5 pounds. You know you're going to overeat. You must try extra hard today. And that means you," he shouted, pointing at me, even though I had positioned myself in the back of the room, hoping to disappear into the wallpaper like a Francesca Woodman self-portrait. Kimmy Polly was sprawled out next to me, a natural at warm-ups, stretches, and dance routines. Her mom had been teaching jazzercise in their living room with no mirrors since her parents' divorce. Kimmy was my best friend, my bright angel. We became inseparable in 4th grade when I lured her into collaborating with me on a publication I was creating. It was a hybrid of my dad's 2 favorite magazines, Playboy and Sports Illustrated. I called it Sex Illustrated, and together we would draw unclothed stick figures with exaggerated body parts in compromising positions. Kimmy was a combination platter of Farrah, Brigitte, and Raquel. She lived on figurines, those crunchy diet bars. She was 75 pounds, and she swore by nice and easy, with riveting turquoise eyes, narrow hips, and enormous tits, real ones. But she never, ever felt like she was enough. The girls at school thought she was conceited and kept their distance. They didn't realize that she was shy and insecure. It was hard for anyone to grasp that someone who looked like she did could be plagued with self-doubt. I didn't fit in anywhere either, and she gave me a place to fill and the room to be myself. It was her breathlessness, her open heart, and her willingness to connect that drew me to her. Richard Simmons in his black tank unitard was sizing Kimmy up like she was the only girl in the room. After class, we gathered at the roughage salad bar, but Richard Simmons grabbed Kimmy and dragged her away from the party to a woman with frosted hair and a fake-looking face who'd been waiting to meet her. She wasn't wearing a danskin. The three of them huddled together for at least 15 minutes. I was about to get in line for seconds when Kimmy finally returned, blushing and frazzled. I was just invited to pose for Playboy, she blurted out. That lady I've been talking to is their photo editor. She is on the great Playmate hunt, scouting nationwide for a centerfold for their 25th anniversary issue. She thinks I'm it, Playmate of the Year. I don't know what she sees in me. Ruthie's mom announced that it was time to open presents. She'd brought a Hanson's birthday cake, but everyone was too embarrassed to eat it in front of Richard Simmons, so she decided to leave it in the car. Someone gave Ruthie an oversized satin pillow in the shape of a Baby Ruth candy bar. It got tossed around the roughage like a volleyball, and within minutes was in shreds. So, are you going to spread your legs for Playboy? I asked Kimmy. It's tempting, she said. She offered me thousands of dollars. I told her, I'm only 16. She said they'd work around it. I could lie about my age. I told her, my dad reads that magazine. I don't want him to open up the centerfold, start beating off, and then realize it's me. I said no. No. Even for that much money, I couldn't live with myself. I was proud of Kimmy and stunned by her flash decision. She'd wanted to be a famous model and actress since grade school. This could have been her big break, her ticket to becoming a Bond girl or an infomercial star. It would be the only time in Kimmy's life that she would hang on to herself. Look, I wasn't any more stable. I had no idea how to balance food or emotions. Small portions made me feel unloved. Anorexia was on the rise and I kept getting bigger. I had a grease tooth, lived on fast food. It made me break out. A dermatologist diagnosed me with a condition called McDonald's acne. Binging and restrictions helped to numb feelings of guilt, depression, and shame. Hostess products gave me a rush that felt like the way I had imagined intimacy. That day at the roughage, Richard Simmons put his arm around me like a concerned father and said, I've been watching you. You're a pretty girl, but you need to lose 10 pounds now before it becomes 20 later. And it will. Why was everything a mixed message? Why do we all have to think thin to be considered lovable? Worthy. It would take years for me to learn to treat myself with gentleness, compassion, and finally, acceptance. By 1990, the average age a girl started dieting had dropped to 8 years old. Kimmy managed to stay skinny her whole life. She never did pose for Playboy. It was Candy Loving who'd win the great Playmate hunt of 1979. But Dorothy Stratton would become Playboy's shiniest star, pegged as the next Marilyn Monroe, appearing in their August issue, and then as Playmate of the Year in 1980. It scares me how much she resembled Kimmy. They could have been twins. Stratton would lose her life at 20 to all of the beautiful, ugly things that make this place LA. She was ensnared long before she was murdered. As for Kimmy, she was delicate as a hybrid tea rose, fragile, broken in the box. When we were girls, I wanted to be her, but when I realized that would never happen, I tried to save her again and again. Kimmy was too consumed with feelings of inadequacy to find any prolonged joy. She battled depression, an eating disorder, a series of bad relationships, and addiction. At 42, she would jump 17 stories off a balcony in Marina Del Rey. There was always this part of me, call it my core, an inner strength, a knowing that I would be okay no matter what. There was always this part of her, call it her core, a knowing that she would never feel safe, never find love, never soar. Her lingering essence both comforts and haunts me. Her absence, a reminder of my presence. And I have never felt so close to anyone before or since. Thank you. So that was called The Beautiful Ugly. This is an old faithful of mine called I Wanted Him. I wanted him, this guy who sliced meat into cold cuts at Encino Deli. Bologna, salami, pastrami, belly locks, no socks, no underwear, crisp white t-shirt without stains, careless and low slung 501s, careless before it was cool. I wanted him, this cross between William Catt in Carrie and a Dickensian parish boy. I'd been sneaking looks at the joy of sex in my parents' hidden cabinet, and he became the person I'd picture it with. He was larger than life, surround sound. He looked like he'd been around and around. Peter Frampton, Roger Daltrey, Robert Plant, every golden-haired rock icon rolled into one. And even behind that deli counter, he was someone. I wanted him through the chocolate phosphates, the Bialy specials, the halva bars, and was pulled in by the way he'd stare at me through my entire meal. He'd stare at me through my entire meal, and it made me feel seen. I wanted him, for I was used to mama's boys, the price of their toys, their bragging rights, their allowances, their 5 and 10 year plans. Where were the cowboys on my brother's flannel pajamas? Where were the lumberjacks from Here Come the Brides? I wanted him. There was no hiding it. My mom had taught me to fall in love with love, not where to find it, not how to work it, love as the only answer. Her Bible was a book of poems called There Are Men Too Gentle to Live Among Wolves. I wanted him because when I would try and imagine the men in those poems, the ones my mom seemed to long for, I wondered what was wrong with them. Why weren't they stoned and reckless? Those were the kind that I leaned towards. I wanted him as he'd stand on his feet for hours at a time while the neighborhood schlubs whined that the Novo was too salty. I knew he was deep beneath the drugs, durable too, and the only other non-Jew in Encino besides my best friend. Yet the more caring he was, yet the more caring I was, the less he stared. I wanted him to press me up against the old Encino oak, but when I spoke, it was clear I was a virgin on the pill, still waiting for the right first. My Bible was a book of poems called My Song for Him Who Never Sang to Me. The men in those poems weren't gentle or reckless, just hit-and-run absentees. I wanted him to deliver bags of bagels to my house, comp my egg creams, drink club margaritas from the same can. He was the only man who could pull the Tel Aviv out of me, straighten my curls, make me Norwegian like he was. I wanted him to give me a ride in his VW bug that during a flash flood had rolled down Laurel Canyon by itself, crashed into a series of parked cars and survived. Even with his hands in the pepper beef, turkey breast, lean strips of tongue, it was 1978. I was 15 years young, had a brother who beat me with words in his fists, and I saw this postmodern Oliver Twist as my way out of the valley. I wanted him to undress me in his car and teach me the secret to dreaming. So I stole all my dad's quarters, cashed them in for dollar bills, took the RTD to the Whole Earth Marketplace in Woodland Hills, and I bought him a glass bong. And then I shaved it all into the shape of a heart, read the sensuous woman, memorized the tricks, and I asked him to please take me to the Styx concert. I wanted him, so I didn't tell my folks that after the show, we would go back to his apartment in Tarzana, where I would bring not only my mood ring, but my new favorite record, In Through the Outdoor by Led Zepp. It was common knowledge that if you took a wet rag and rubbed it against the album's inner sleeve, it would leave behind the black and white drawings, transform them to permanently colored. I wanted him, as if being in his presence seemed to heal me from convention, certainty, and excess. It was nothing less than awakening to muffled speech that revealed itself in reverse. Backmasking and lock grooves were all the rage, and I was underage then, decoding subliminal messages from album covers, imagining older men as lovers, navigating firsts. I wanted him. Even as it hurt in his bed, I focused on what I could see. His hair, golden movie star ringlets that smelled like Flex shampoo. His hands too, away from the meat cutting machine, far more serene than one would think. His body, sinewy and covered in freckles. Kisses from God, Mom called them. I had them too. I wanted him, though his girlfriend stared at us from her senior portrait, so he turned it around, made her face the wall. As I recall, when it was over, I wasn't invited back for a year. What's become clear is that for decades, I carried him along as blueprint. And in those I've loved, there has always been a hint of the grown-up orphan, the waif-like fable boy groomed on the street. Who knew his touch would unseat me? I wanted him. So I try things out on other men, some who sign their lives away on me, let me steal their wild for free. The butterfly flick, the dog and pony show. Afraid of the slowdown, the love scene, I would try things out on other men and think, one day I'll come back and show you what I've learned. I didn't care that he wanted nothing to do with me. I wanted him, all because when he would stare at me from behind that counter, I felt seen. And finally, I hope I have time to read this, Harry, because you are in this piece. I write these tributes sometimes on Facebook when people I loved have died and people I've loved from afar. And this one is called Rest in Peace, Robert Forster. And it's 7/13/41 to 10/11/19. So this was written the day that he died. The first time I laid eyes on Robert Forster was 40 years ago. I was a senior at Birmingham High, and nearly every night, a small group of us would drive over the hill from Encino to hang out on the patio of Joe Allen in West Hollywood, where the extremely striking and somewhat mysterious Bob Forster would hold court with a group of post-middle-age, coffee-drinking actor friends who would sit there for hours, regaling each other with tales of auditions, near misses, and a handful of hits. All former thespians, most of whom were flat broke, but still ridiculously cocky. One of these men was my soon-to-be long-term boyfriend, the dashing and at one time kind of famous TV movie star, Wayne Maunder, 25 years my senior. See Once Upon a Time in Hollywood for more info. Then there was Lenny DeJean, Michael Dante, and Eric Weston. Each had his own sad story about getting close to success, but then watching as it slipped away. Most of them were palpably bitter and rather loud, convening to share dirty jokes and crack each other up, a kind of respite from enduring the lives they'd chosen and were hanging on to as aging actors with minimal prospects. And they would rank the young and older actresses parading through the restaurant, with the exception of Robert Forster, who was visibly polite and respectful. They were not so nice to women. The waitresses despised them, would take their nominal tips and tolerate their pre-Me Too humor. One of these guys lured wannabe actresses up to his apartment, claiming he was a photographer. He would guarantee them modeling work, pretending to take artistic pictures. He'd get them to take their tops off, etc., and later berate them to the other guys at the table at Joe Allen because he'd shot them with no film in his camera. For me, escaping from Encino and lingering on the patio of Joe Allen was the definition of success, a promise of what life could be if only I could get out of the valley once and for all. I was 16, young for my grade. My friends and I were LA's version of the bridge and tunnel crew. We'd eat our Cobb salads, drink iced tea, and gossip about what had just happened on General Hospital. The other tables were filled with recognizable working actors, directors, producers, and LA artists. I wanted to be in the loop, some loop. I wanted to be an actress and a poet or a playwright and live inside the swirl. Anything was better than being relegated to a coffee shop on Ventura Boulevard and calling it nightlife. Around this same time, my Mapplethorpe-esque artist friend Craig and I created a new ritual, getting taco salads from the drive-thru at Noggles once a week and heading over to the Sunset Plaza apartments, where we'd sit by the pool, dine from our takeout boxes, and pretend we belonged in old Hollywood. Craig was obsessed with the movie American Gigolo, and it was shot at that location. One of the highlights of doing this was getting to see Robert Forster, who lived there. On numerous occasions, we'd watch him late at night as he walked some ingenue to her car after a long evening. Later, when the building was sadly torn down, I'd heard he moved to Holloway Drive and everyone knew he could be found commiserating at Theodore, which later became the Silver Spoon, a Schwab's-like cafe where that late-night crowd at Joe Allen hung out and drank coffee by day. Wayne and I moved to West Hollywood, not far from Joe Allen, residing in a small apartment on Westbourne Drive. We weren't really in love, per se, and it was more of a companionship, but we were inseparable. And then the climate of my social life changed, and my friends and I started hanging out at bars like the Formosa, Coronet Pub, Ports, and Bordner's. I was finally 21. Wayne was 46. Some of the characters from the Joe Allen crowd had ironically moved their act to the Valley of all places and could be found in faux French cafes such as L'Express or Rive Gauche in Sherman Oaks. Meanwhile, in town, Wayne bartended at the Rain Check Room and had the occasional audition. I waitressed at Cafe Figaro and read about 1,000 Sam French plays, but never found the leverage or even the momentum to be a working actress. As the 80s rolled on, my life became less about Wayne and filled with younger actors and poetry readings and punk and new wave clubs. And then a playwriting workshop called Padua came along and transformed me. It was enough and filling. I wrote poems all the time, plays too, and I became immersed in the spoken word scene, which was more inviting, more accepting, more inclusive than that other industry. Many years passed. Wayne and I broke up after almost a decade. I was single and carefree for a brief period of wild until I met and moved in with and later married another actor, this time more of a working one, Christopher Allport. We ended up living a million miles away from Joe Allen in Santa Monica with Chris's young son, Andrew. At some point, Joe Allen closed down. I started attending Holly Prado's writing workshop. Then there was that day in 96 when I told Chris I was pregnant with our son, Mason. He was elated and a little freaked out because he didn't know if he had the money to support me and two children. I told him not to worry, that my book would sell for $500,000 and I could support the whole family forever. Besides, it was common knowledge, babies bring a breadbasket. Sure enough, just after giving birth to Mason, Chris started working nonstop, and we were taking our new baby on location with us from the time he was 9 days old. One of those outings included heading to Dallas, where Chris guest starred in Walker, Texas Ranger. This is where we would get to spend most of our days and nights with Robert Forster, who was also guest starring on that same episode. I'd never met more of a gentleman. Never, ever. He was old time, had a Clark Gable and the Misfits air about him, like an at once tidy, well-groomed, and yet rugged, street-smart character in a Hitchcock film. From another era, and though that era seemed to have passed, he was still living in it. And not in a way that was stuck in nostalgia unappealing, but like he was in his own private movie that had never ended. The work days got extended and we were all together for at least a couple of weeks, like an instant family, sharing meals, long talks, old stories. During the times Chris was on set working, I'd be in the coffee shop at the hotel with my baby Mason on my lap. Forster would often be at the same table across the room and he would invite me to sit with him or pick up the tab without saying anything. He and Chris became fast friends and would have this ongoing competition about who got killed more on screen as an actor. And they'd go back and forth about the worst ways they died. I believe Bob won for having had fireworks strapped to him after being tied to a Ferris wheel or some such thing. They were trying to outdo each other, but in a healthy, humorous, actorly way. One day we were all sitting around at breakfast when Forster's flip phone rang and he excused himself. I gotta take this, he said. It's a call from Tarantino. He wants me to be in his next movie. I gave Chris that look like, yeah, right. Who is he kidding? Later, Forster would get nominated for an Academy Award for his role in Jackie Brown, and he would never stop working. Many poems and stories later, my novel never sold. Chris would die for real, and I'd raise our young son by myself. I'd find solace and friendship and even find love a couple times. And I created my show Library Girl out of a longing for that kind of community we all seek and try to find here in our own way. Through the theater scene, at music venues, poetry readings, meetings with friends for hours, drinking coffee at diners or drinking cocktails or soda water at bars, and eating breakfast at night and ranting about our love lives at neighborhood restaurants. The thing is, after Chris died, Forster started showing up again everywhere, not just in so many TV shows and movies, but in my real life, like in 1979, 1980s West Hollywood. Wherever I'd go, I'd see him there too. He'd been through countless eras as an actor in Hollywood, a gazillion ups and downs, and survived with grace and calm and with the smooth ease of someone who hadn't lost or struggled. It was as if he was as ageless and he'd always be around, no matter what, like those guys in Jimmy Webb's Highwayman song. As it turned out, he and I had a couple mutual friends, specifically two of my favorite guy friends. He was close to poet Harry Northup, would read with him at Beyond Baroque poetry events that Harry would organize. We read in one together. He got this glazed-eyed look on his face, like he knew me from somewhere, but he couldn't place it. Yeah, I was older, but so was he. I delighted in being on a bill with him, reading poetry. The last time I saw him was at the Motion Picture Television Fund, where he and several other poets and actors gave an astounding reading of Leaves of Grass, not even a year ago. And he was tight with my dear friend, the exceptional singer-songwriter J.D. Hinton, another rare gentleman from that same old school. Forster would always come to shows whenever and wherever J.D. was performing. But I knew there was something wrong when he was supposed to read at Holly Prado's memorial in August and wasn't able to make it. And when he didn't come to watch the co-founders of Cahuenga Press read in Holly's honor at Library Girl last month. And when I didn't see him the night J.D. performed at the Rose in Pasadena just weeks ago, he showed up for the ones he cared about the most. And when he didn't, you noticed. I never really got to know Robert Forster well enough, only peripherally, but I treasure the time we all spent together in Texas. And I can say with certainty that he was a loyal, devoted friend. He was always, always handsome. He got better with age. And he was a damn great actor, a serious one who never gave up and watched it all come around again, his eye never veering from the prize. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan, for that fabulous reading. Your reading has emotional honesty. It has a sensuousness to it, a strength of line. And that was just a lovely elegy for Robert Forster. And thank you for letting us know about your life. And you're just a wonderful reader and writer. And thank you once again, Susan Hayden.
Thank you so much.
Our next reader is Celeste Goyer. Born in Northampton, Massachusetts, Celeste Goyer has lived in California since age 11, mostly in remote towns of the Mojave and Great Basin deserts. She edited a literary quarterly for 14 years, hosted a poetry series, and had poems published in many journals, including Apercus, Times Times Three, and Text Objects. Celeste has also contributed a lot to the poetry community, in particular to Cahuenga Press, for which I'm thankful. Celeste Goyer looks at landscapes and reality in a new and surreal way with humor, revelation, and a clarity of language. A superb poet, Celeste Goyer.
Thank you, Harry, so much. Thank you, Susan, that was amazing. And thank you, Jennifer, and everybody on the crew. Now, this is the 95th episode, and I'm so excited to be part of it. I'd like to start by reading two poems that aren't mine. One is by Holly Prado, and the next one will be by Harry Northup, poets I greatly admire. The one by Holly is from Esperanza, Poems for Orpheus. and it's called The Tall Upheaving One. The cypress that I pray to, it can fly. Nothing is a single species. We're made of bark, then avalanche. Orpheus can make us anything, can make us God's own door. Cypress or oak or black, to be accepted there, across the boundary, as when I leave the house this morning walking, nothing painful in my legs. I tell misunderstanding, this is our last year together. Then I see just up the street that planets are our bodies. Their mouths slam through my wrists. I was a child who practiced jumping from the top of anything right into the air. Music was a swirl of vines and leaves that left my throat. I'm calling, and I'm waiting, and I'm called to. This black, this pure unknown which finds its way, exactly like the song you can't get rid of, the one I start with now and won't give up. The God, obsessed with worship that is memorized, abiding, until the prayer itself moves inside out, converts these worlds of sliding rock to fragrance. I'm calling, and I'm calling, and I'm called. And from Love Poem to MPTF, Harry's recent book, a poem called First Morning. A young woman brushing her hair, yellow flowers like stars in the sky, remorseless circle of hands, circles upon circles into depth, a hieroglyph reaching outwards, petals falling, an Egypt of cares, compassion at last sewn between fingers, to see small birds like petals fly from the center seeds, an astonishment with no regard for the closing spiky darkness. A bird among dried out stalks, branches without leaves in blue sky, a cutting open of deadness with water. Deliver, banish, bring back, regenerate song. O muse, sing bird, sing spring, beloved brightness on lips, spring light. Thank you for writing that, Harry. A beautiful song. Poem. And the work of mine I'm going to share today is from an unpublished manuscript called The Shoes of Our Guests that I am seeking a publisher for. They are prose poems, which means if you look at them on the page, they'll be in paragraph form and will not have short lines. The first one was written in response to the global news, which is so disheartening. And if you're like me, you feel helpless in the face of its awfulness. So, and the pandemic has certainly been a continuation of that as well. So this piece came and it's called, I'm a Useless Trivial Hairball. With my empathy engine in high gear after the lentils and beans, I can't cook meat in the kitchen. So I draw birds and flowers on waxed bags that I inherited. I like to cook. I like hanging suspended in the shade of tall trees, writing on bread. I admit I'm a loser of this world. I'm part of it. I live here on a rock, stolen, doing nothing for my beans and peas. And each of my years, the steak burns away to smoke at the bottom of my list of a million reasons why I'm so small and stupid. Why do I even live here? The roof of the house is a tender, bright green color, and I'm doing nothing to protect it from oxidation, from autumn, from birds, from the coming snow. If anyone finds this, tell it I'm sorry. I wanted to help. No one deserves hail the size of softballs. I'm no good. I can't improve anything. I live here with the words, a great traitor, sewn on my shirts. Why can't I stop the 400-pound bear from moving into the kitchen, the hot tub? I can't concentrate while you're nailing your hats to the walls, so I'm writing this letter in the oven on bread, scratching words on it with a tiny needle. Yes, I'm sick. I'm part of the entire problem of sickness. I have a big key to this rock, stolen, with the words pretending everything's okay on it, a motto I can't escape. The hail's pounding the roof again, and I'm wasting years sewing birds and flowers on my own forehead. Is this proof I'm actually already dead? I hope you know how difficult these words are to spell that prove that everything is fine. I hope you're aware of the complexity while you nail your final hat to the wall. I do grasp that this is the most important issue. I hope to understand it one day, if anyone finds it, by tracing backwards from the stolen goods my happiness is built on. My head aches from this guilt as I make nightgowns and write letters in the oven. I can handle anything except the coming bad years, but still I want to help. The bowels of the earth stand here sucking up sun. What heavy words these are. Can I catch all these things that I will neither develop nor acquire? I'm stating this as plainly as I can stand to under these conditions. I see it as a big problem, ending my list of millions of excuses while the floor is melting to lava under the front door and good food is everywhere except in the right kitchens. I have to look inside the bears and hope for some understanding one day. I destroyed this place. I'm part of it. I can't prove that everything's fine. I hear you clearly with my remaining good ear. And an older piece of mine called Song About the Deer. In this narrow, powder-soft library, we spend our lunch money nervously on white cloth napkins, a pair of scissors. We are learning to act, to sing, vivacious beginners who hope no one notices when we fall from the stove to the table. On a snowy roof, our teacher lifts his greatcoat, releasing the gorgeous owls. But the last handful, so much quieter, sit protected in their sleepy nursery. They feed on our insecurity in an orderly yet kind way. The body, all we really have here in our cross-legged circle, maps out our odd or even future. I'm shaking like a lilac, begging with a soft shoe breath. The mates are sweaters lost behind furniture, wait, their cobwebbed arms waving in the warm furnace currents. My tongue fell behind in the song about the deer as we glued our masks into dark triangle noses, and everywhere my limbs, my tongue. The new lightweight eggs. Tonight's moon wears yellow tulle and carries a prop sword before her bosom, guarding our sleepiness. I'm vaguely jealous to see my evening dresses walking about the garden without me, measuring for flower beds and gazebos with those unfolding wooden yardsticks. I remember how happy you were when you discovered the bridge they sent you by mistake. You buried the old man under it on New Year's Day in 1979. Four new worlds started slowly spinning then, and as they turned, their shiny petals opened. One old world expired with a groan in its own muddy branches. You never spoke its name again. It's just dark enough to make out the pinhole view of Raymond Chandler's final bedroom floating on the wall above your desk, covered as it is with crumpled Beethoven sonatas. He realized there were questions we really don't want to answer, such as, do you want this job or not? At midnight, the rocking motion of your chair slowly stops. Fog shaky and soft, repairs such parts of it as it can before sunrise. On the wooden stairs, my tiny horses stomp up to bed. We return to where we love, what we love. 22 episodes will tell the story. Is my audio okay?
Yes.
What dreams learn about us. All night the road rises. Palm trees grow tall, fall down, and grow back. We're nude, in a rush, stuck rummaging through boxes of single socks, ski hats, racks of nightgowns, and huge sequined bras. Nothing even remotely fits or matches. Our abandoned responsibilities whistle, so we hustle on, past hungry guests waiting at tables with no menus, no beverages, no utensils. It's understood we'll never manage to find them again, treat them well. Their sad eyes follow us. Each part of the city we see only once, our route, a crumpled map. The dreams cringe when we climb into cars. We are hopeless drivers, missing turns, launching off cliffs, driving into air. On foot, we're worse, born lost, trespassing to find our way back. Just once, we made a famous actor laugh in a supermarket. We seemed smart and prepared for once. But the dreams tap their feet. They have no time to study either our many errors or what it is that we actually want as it all slides along under our steaming pillows, devoid of plot, of character development. We sleep a lot, shocked and scared. We learn nothing that we can remember. The dreams lose patience. And now they're gone, our dear babysitter dreams. And they hid the door to their own real buildings, clouds, streets. This one is for Ron Ozuna. Pictures of birds. Here we are again at work in the morning on our pictures of birds. I drove to the usual places. I said hi to everyone, forgetting what happened last year, the year of glass faces. As you will see, I did not find many birds on this trip. A peculiar silent flatness arrived on February 19th. I got up at 2:30, but most of the geese and cranes had already flown north. No one was there on the lake, cold and salty as desire. As you can see, my photos are finicky, oddly impersonal. Another morning of working, hoping that all will be well. In this way, I move without any movement. Here is a photo of the last bird. If you're on Ron Ozuna's email list, you get his wonderful photos of birds that he takes by traveling around to all the migration sites and the other places where they gather. So that poem was created using the material from his emails that he sends. During the pandemic, it was such a joy to see those pictures and to enjoy the kind of the peace and the calmness of the settings. So thank you, Ron, for that. Okay, two more. Let's get lost. I had a friend who once told me women tend to get lost in their relationships. So this was based on that prompt. Let's get lost. I'll need a mother's sentences to protect my story from harm. My story of women getting lost in their relationships. I'll need words with more hands, like tree branches. Families, no matter how loving, need a back door. As we see the huge world gather around us, we rush to slip free of caution. We drop the family map and fall into the opening where the woman's character is born, that terra incognita. I was in the dark, on the sidelines, but proud of my life. I'd picked up this map one wet and freezing day to prove that women don't have to disappear into calm, decorated photographs. I woke up as a couple, taking root in the trunk of someone else's car, leaning backwards. It's true, women in relationships disappear like fruits into the swollen questions where they live, wondering how they came into this composition, then looking to disappear again, with many a squirmy official break and camouflage jumpsuit lying down on wrong way tracks. I woke up with a handful of false starts, but no lines of my own. You might say I was a Christmas cold, traveling into relationships like fruit into ghastly brand new kitchens, photographed, but never still. I cheated a lot at first with various border huts in the snow. It was in fact rubble made of ice until early morning spilled its guts. My excuses stepped back. It was an early morning step back world in someone else's car with three broken flowers on the seat, trapped, my head stuffed on the wall, gathering fruit flies in a bowl, hopeful, but ultimately silent, in a car where passengers ride alone. And then finally, this poem was written by trying to visually decipher Japanese characters called kanji to see what they might look like. Kanji speak to me. I'm traveling to Japan on a bicycle powered by rainwater. It will take 4 weeks to get there. My rucksack holds rice, fish, tea. I am a woman running from a small man with an airplane, the sun over the mountains too big to eat. I'm leaving Tokyo tonight in an electric car delivering sushi. I've had too many alcohol, three too many to go far. It will take 7 hours for the fire to go out in the rice field and 2 years to forget what that woman said to me. I am a small fish from a rainy river, too small to eat. Osaka authorities asked me to come and speak about meat. I'm allowing 3 weeks to write my speech, 5 minutes to deliver it. I'd rather be climbing a big mountain with tea and rice in a rucksack. Too few bicycles, not enough sun. On Hokkaido, men wrap women in three strands of barbed wire before going out to work in the morning. They generate electricity by wrapping fish in rice. Sun over the river means no rain tomorrow.
Oh, fabulous. That was a lovely reading, Celeste. Thank you very much. I find that there's a gentleness, a depth, empathy, and compassion in your poetry, an illumination of the human heart. And, you know, just thank you very much. I have a couple of questions. Number one, Celeste, when did you write your first poem?
I was 12, and it was an orange portable typewriter. And I have to say that Bob Dylan was largely involved. It wasn't very good.
Now, when you sit down to write, what do you focus on? Do you have an idea, an emotion, a visual, image, words?
I guess I have an unusual process in that my initial material I write, it sometimes comes from memories. It sometimes comes from found material. But then it's the process of transforming it using various operations. I do have some sort of John Cage-like chance operations that I do with the work that puts it off into a more mysterious territory that's generally extremely different from the way I start. But it's always surprising and fun. Doesn't always work out, but when it does, it doesn't seem like something I wrote personally.
You know, I was going to ask, we have about 4 minutes left, and I was going to ask Susan a question too, if I may. Susan, when you sit down to write, What do you focus on? Do you have an image? Do you have words? Do you have a memory? What do you focus on when you initially sit down to begin to write?
I usually begin with a question.
With a what?
With a question.
Question.
Yeah, like I have a question about something that I'm trying to answer, but I don't have the answer to.
Do you include the question in the poem, or
no.
Do you keep that behind it?
No, it's behind it, but it's there. And that goes for a play, a story, a poem. Yeah, I mean, images, yes. Memories, of course. But it's that question that keeps it going for me.
And I'll ask this question of each of you, starting with Celeste. You both have been writing for quite a few years. What would you, Celeste, tell a young woman who sat down to write a poem for the first time? What would you tell her to focus on?
I think Susan's just given away a great tip in her question method. But I guess just let the larger, the collective unconscious come through. And keep your doors and windows open. It would be my first tip. And then secondly, I would say you have seen a lot in your life. It's all been absorbed into you. And if you let it come through, an amazing detail can emerge. And obviously concrete detail must be balanced with the idealism that we often feel that gets us to the page. But keep writing and focus on the work. Don't worry about publishing or anything else but the work.
And how about you, Susan? What advice would you give to a young poet who sits down to write her first poem? What would you tell her to focus on?
I would just say, be honest, no hiding.
And Celeste, what are a couple of your influences in poetry?
Definitely John Ashbery. I also love so many others, you and Holly, James Tate, of course, the greats, Keats, Hart Crane.
And how about you, Susan? Who are some of your influences in poetry or prose?
Oh, Harry Northup, Holly Prado, all the LA poets that I love, of course. Singer-songwriters. I love Lucille Clifton. I love Sharon Olds. I love Keats. But I love Bukowski, of course. I love Sam Shepard. So some of the playwrights that have informed my life and the singer-songwriters have had more power over my work than poets.
Well, you both are very generous, and you've given a lot, not only through your poetry, but to your care and help and support of other poets. And here's, so I want to thank you both for that. And I would, since you both mentioned Keats, before I turn this over to Jennifer, I would just like to say that you are both bright stars. Thank you for the reading, the fabulous reading. And here's our wonderful director, Jennifer Clymer.
Thanks, Harry. Thanks, Jennifer.
Can I ask a question of you both before you, well, actually of all three of you before you go?
Sure.
When Harry talks about inspiration and what you would say to poets that are up and coming, I love to tag on with that. Rewriting is such an important part of many people's process. But when inspiration kind of strikes, whether it's from a dedicated practice of I sit down every day, I write three pages regardless of what's on the page, or just this came to me in a dream and I've written it down. How important is the rewriting of that, the spark? You know what I mean? So taking apart the discipline of this is what I do all the time. If you are moved by the muse in a way that makes you take up a pen and write it down right away, is that something that you feel you have to honor the purity of that moment and not rework it? Or is there room for all of that? Like, what is that process?
Well, I will answer the question first. To me, it's what sustains itself. In other words, if you write something that's good and then, you know, you leave it alone and you look back a couple of months later and it has strength and it's fulfilling to me, that's what I choose. You know, not everything you write obviously is good, but you just use ultimately everything, you know, it's like whatever it takes and is this make it? And that's what I would say. And then let's just go to Celeste and then Susan.
Well, we don't have much time. I'll just quickly quote poet James Cushing, who always says, the first draft has one job, and that is to become the second draft. But the rewriting is the juice. That's the concert. The other stuff is the ticket. But the fun part is the rewriting. So don't be afraid of it.
Susan?
I love getting inspiration. But I have to say that the rewriting to me, I'm a compulsive rewriter and it kills me. I hate it, but I do it. And I think it's absolutely essential. And sometimes I never feel like something is done, but I know that initial inspiration rarely is what the piece is going to be for me, whatever form I'm writing in. It's not like, oh yeah, I wrote that on a whim and it's great. No.
All right. So as a quick follow-up, because I know we're over time already, in your rewriting, do you find that you are editing out or you are augmenting?
Well, for me, if there's something that doesn't ring true, I will edit it out, obviously, because you want each word and each line to count. So it really comes down to making each word count. Celeste and then Susan?
Yes, it's both. And sometimes you may find you've written two poems and you need to take them apart from each other, or they may want to be added to a different poem and become longer. So it can be any of that.
Yes, same. I would say the same.
Beautiful. Thank you both so much for the time and for making the 95th episode extraordinary.
Yay. Thank you. Thank you, Harry.
Thanks, Harry. Thanks, everybody.
Love you.
So, Harry, please share with us what's happening next week, and if you can, the week after, because next week is a bit of a unique situation.
Next week, because we have a wonderful actor on the campus, John Towie, and he does this great presentation of the poetry of Richard Wilbur, who's won two Pulitzers. And we're going to do a rerun of a show he did last year to celebrate his 101st birthday, if he would have been alive. And then the following Tuesday, we're going to have residents read the poetry from Lady of the Lake by Diane Wachowski, a tribute to Diane Wachowski.
Wonderful. Harry, thank you. Susan, Celeste, lovely to see you all.